Good morning. Good morning, everybody, and welcome to our workshop today. We will have today the topic clay analysis Putumayo Basin, and we have three speakers today: Iván Olaya, Arles Gutierrez, and Maria Cecilia Ruiz. I wanted to maybe to summarize to all of you the number of attendees for country that we have had on those 14 previous workshops. So we are very happy to have these numbers. I mean, total attendees, 2,600, nationals, 2,100, foreigners, 500. And we have had an audience of 27 countries around the world in preparation to Ronda 2021. So don't forget that we are, at this time, we are just offering 33 areas, 28 proposed by the agency, and five more nominated by the industry. So that's good news. Don't forget that you can incorporate or nominate areas in open acreage in the country. And that is the purpose of this workshop, to encourage all of you to promote, to nominate or incorporate areas to this process. Well, we are just in the middle or just almost finalizing our cycle two. We have to Putumayo Basin today. Next week, we are going to have a very interesting session. We will have Cesar Ranchería, Caribe, Cordillera. We will have the Universidad de Caldas, the UIS University participating with us next time, next week. And we will have the contribution of the agency as always. And we will close our cycle two with the topic conventional and unconventional resources of Colombia yet to find on August 13. Okay, I have some news to give to you. I mean, we will start our third cycle from August 20 to November 12. Remember that the end of this process will be November 17 during the summit, the petroleum summit organized by the industry in Bogota. So we will go on with those Fridays talks, workshops until then. Okay, the third cycle in that period will include very interesting things. We will update you with our new findings in the area that we are offering. I mean, the group here has been working and during those months, I mean, during those, while we are presenting those workshops, the team here is working and improving our opportunities. And we will be sure that all those updating will be given to you before the round. In addition to that, I mean, the good news that we have is that, as you know, the agency in the past has prepared some materials on already discovered and developed reservoirs, and also on areas of producing fields that are given back to the ANS. I'm sorry, I have a spelling problem on the slide, but it's producing field given back to the ANH. So we are organizing those couple of products already discovered and developed reservoirs and producing fields given back to the ANH. And we will prepare those packages, and those packages will be presented to you during those weeks. So that in order to encourage you to incorporate or nominate those areas on those specific opportunities that we will present to you during those weeks. And the last good news that I have for students today, for students of geology and petroleum engineer, is that we are working very hard, the ANH and MinCiencias, on structuring an economic support for pre-graduate thesis in frontier areas in Colombia. I am going to give you more details of that, of this news, but I think that this is a good way to encourage our young guys or young professionals to go and evaluate a lot of things that have that are present in the Caribbean, offshore, in the Chocó onshore and offshore, and in the Tumaco onshore and offshore, in the Cauca Patía, in the Caguana, and in the Cordillera. Those are the areas that the agency considers frontier areas. Okay, so that's a very good news for them, and I will give you some more details shortly, the amount of money that we will give to them and the process, because everything will be obviously worked through the universities as well. Okay, so today we have the pleasure to have Iván Olaya, Dr. Iván Olaya again, and for the people that do not know, Iván Olaya, he is a geologist, graduated from the U.S. University in Colombia in 1988. He has a Master of Science in Geology from the Colorado School of Mines in 1997. Iván is also a Master of Business Administration. He also did a Master of Business Administration, MBA, on the Universidad de los Andes in 2015. He's a specialist in exploration geophysics, also from the Colorado School of Mines in 1989, and he's also a specialist in international management on hydrocarbons from the Universidad de los Andes, 2012. Iván has had experience in the industry as follows: Ecopetrol 17 years, in Hocol 2 years, in Pacific Rubiales 8 years, and in Manzaro Park Energy, he has been working during the last 4 years. Iván is also a professor, and as you know, a great speaker and promoter of the opportunities in Colombia. And we highly appreciate Iván, what you is doing for promoting the opportunities in the country. And we highly appreciate it as a Colombian people. And we have also Arles Gutierrez, who is currently working for the agency. And Arles is a geologist, graduated from the National University in 2006. He was part of the certificate program in geoscience, Petrogroup Training and Consulting Company. That was an agreement with the Universidad de Oklahoma in 2011. He also ran did a diplomado en gerencia de proyectos 2012, and Arles has worked for Gran Tierra 6 years from 2007 to 2012. He worked after that 1 year for Emerald, and he has been during the last 4 years working for the ANH. And we have the pleasure to have a new employee in the ANH. And that is Maria Cecilia Ruiz. We are very happy to have Maria Cecilia with us. As you know, Maria Cecilia, she is a geologist engineer, graduated from the National University of Medellin in 2006. She has a master's science in geophysics from the National University in Bogota. She also has an MBA from the London School of Business in 2016. More than 50 years of experience in the industry. She has worked for Cerrejón, GeoSearch, Halliburton, Schlumberger, Pacific Rubiales, and Vedra. Okay, gentlemen, so thank you for attending our workshop this week. And I will give you the word to Iván.
Okay, thank you, Miguel. Let me share my presentation. Okay. Okay, good morning to everybody. I just want to say thank you, Miguel, for the introduction. Thank you for this invitation. Happy birthday, Miguel. I know that was last week, but God continues blessing you. Today we will travel for the Putumayo Basin, and I will just describe the the main structural features, the stratigraphic changes in the from west to east, and later Maria Cecilia and Alex will talk about the prospectivity. Then starting as usual, we will start with the regional description. I mean, the stratigraphic column, regional cross section, regional seismic section. The as usual also the Bouguer anomaly map to show the structural and in this case I will show the top of the basement map from gravity and magnetics. It's very interesting that work. And also in that regional stuff, describing the petroleum system elements and that stuff. Later we will start with the Putumayo description, starting with the northern zone from Rio Pescado to Unicornio. All the Gran Tierra fields are in that northern zone. Continue with the central zone from the Condor one well to the Area field. The Orito field that is one of also of the main fields in the basin is in the central zone, and we will finish with the Easter zone that is from Caiman to Solita one. I will show you a special or my personal opinion about the Easter zone. For me, there is a huge potential in the Easter zone. For me, there are several Rubiales fields in the Easter zone. I will show you that at the end of this presentation. Okay, let's start with the stratigraphic column of the Putumayo Basin. We will talk about the Caballos formation. Is the main reservoir in this basin. And also we will talk about the Villeta formation, that is the main sort of rock in this basin. Of course, several sandy level of the Villeta are also considered good reservoirs. And we will talk also in the tertiary about the Pepino formation, the Rumiyaco formation as a reservoir in this basin, especially in the eastern side of the Putumayo basin. Here you have also a most specific stratigraphic column from the seismic atlas, Colombia seismic atlas, showing the especially in this part the different what is the log the resistive the log response from each formation, and especially in this part all the geological processes in this basin that are associated with the main for example the main and conformity in the basin is the Eocene and conformity, and also the Miocene and conformity related with the last Andean uplift in the northern South America continent. Okay, then this is a regional stratigraphic correlation from the Putumayo to Llanos, passing through to the Florencia Paleohy, that is the division or the geological division from the Putumayo Basin to the Caguán Basin. You can see here in this correlation that all the stratigraphic column from the Caballos, from Paleozoic, Cretaceous, and lower tertiary strata, lower tertiary formation are pinching out against the Florencia Paleohy. I mean, just the tertiary section is just passing through the Florencia Paleohy and connecting the Putumayo with the Caguán Basin. That's important because you will see during this presentation that there is an important potential in the pinching out of this Cretaceous and lower tertiary formation against the paleohype. Yes, I know it's heavy oil, but it's also an important potential in this part of the basin. This is the regional structural section. You will see that the most complex structural model is in the west side of the basin. I mean, associated with the uplift of the Andean Cordillera in this case. And most of the fields are just a simple structure. I mean, not as spectacular as in the foothill, or as spectacular as in for example in the Middle Magdalena, that you will see especially spectacular thrusting. Or no, here you will see simple anticlines, subtle anticlines. And in the most of the central and east part of the basin, here you will see you are seeing semi section parallel to the cross section in the upper part. You will see that the most complex structure are in the west side, as I mentioned before. And look at the structure of the orthophyll. It's a very nice faulted anticline. Okay, continue with the regional description. Here you have a basement top map from a gravimetric inversion. This is from my friend Alvaro Vargas. And he's proposing a very interesting configuration for the southern part of Colombia. You can see the Putumayo Basin, that is our main topic today in this talk, in this area. The most clear blue colors are associated with the deepest part of the basin, as you know in this gravimetric tool. And he's also proposing the Florencia paleohype separating the from the Caguán basin in the northeast part, and from he's proposing another sub basin, the Puerto Leguizamo sub basin in this area. It's interesting, and the Caquetá and the Chiribiquete sub basins in the eastern part of the Putumayo basin, and also in the eastern part of the Caguán basin. What is important for the petroleum industry of these two basins, especially the Puerto Leguizamo and the Caquetá, as Alex will show you later, in Ecuador there is the continuity, probably the continuity of this sub basin, especially the continuity of the Puerto Leguizamo sub basin in the Ecuador side, is associated with the important discoveries are called the ITT complex, are also heavy oil, and that ITT complex has a huge amount of heavy oil associated with probably the continuity of some of these sub basin. I don't know exactly if it's the Puerto Leguizamo or the Chiriquete or the Caquetá sub basin continuity in the east sides of the Ecuadorian sides of the boundary. What is important from this map also the Alto of Florencia, as I mentioned before, is the eastern end of the most of the Cretaceous and lower tertiary formation. That means you will have here in the eastern side of the Putumayo basin, probably you will have interesting stratigraphy traps for heavy oil mainly. We will show that at the end of this presentation. Okay, Summarizing the petroleum system elements, here you can see the petroleum system basin map showing the extension of the different petroleum systems in this basin. And what is important from the map? Look at that, the migration is from west to east. Please have that in mind for the presentation, because we will analyze different seismic line, different structural model, and have in mind that the migration is mainly from west to east in this basin. I mean, it's different, for example, from the Middle Magdalena, that the migration is from east to west, or Catatumbo, that I showed that like 1 month ago, was also from east to west. No, here in the Putumayo is west to east. And analyzing the chart of the bends in the Putumayo basin, you can see here, for example, that the this is from ANH, I mean, this is public information. You can see that the trap formation started at the Eocene, and some of them also in the Miocene, associated with the last Andean orogeny. And the generation and migration and accumulation of oil started in the early Miocene. That's important during this presentation, because we will analyze the trap and migration and generation and migration ages to analyze the timing for this region. Of course, if we are saying that the main reservoir is Cretaceous, the main salt rock is Cretaceous, and the main oil fields are in Cretaceous rocks, we have to analyze what is the distribution of the Cretaceous sequences in this basin. This is a paper from the Jocol people, I mean, Mora, Mantilla, and Mario de Freitas. And you have here, you can see the extension of, for example, the early to late Albian strata in this in the basin, going almost to the center, almost to the central part from west to east, almost in the central part of the basin. This is interesting, because you will see that the pitch out of these formations, Cretaceous formation, will establish stratigraphic traps. And Maria Cecilia will talk about that, the potential of that stratigraphic traps in this basin. Okay, then let's start our trip. Let's start with the northern zone from Rio Pescado to Unicornio. I say before that, the main Gran Tierra fields are in this northern zone. Then, the first seismic seismic line that we will analyze in this trip is line that is passing through the Rio Pescado well, Mandarina well. Rio Pescado was drilled by Texaco 1967, and Mandarina was drilled by CNC in 2006. This is the structural model for defined by the ICP during the 90s by my friend Roberto Linares. It's interesting. Look at that. It's a interesting structural model. You can see, for example, in the Rio Pescado structure is a little bit older trap than the western side that produce a best timing. Rio Pescado only got some shows in the Cretaceous section, and also Mandarina got shows in the Cretaceous section, but no producial no commercial production is associated with these two wells. Here you have a stratigraphic well log correlation from three wells in the northern part of the Putumayo basin. de mandarina and río pescado are in this area. This strategic correlation is in the eastern part of the of that side midline. What is the importance of that of this structural correlation? Look at that. You have in the basin there is a pinch out of the Rumiñaco formation, of the lower Pepino formation against this paleo high, this basement paleo high. That is called it, as I mentioned it before, is called it the Florencia Paleo High. Of course, we will see later the stratigraphic or the potential for the accumulation of these stratigraphic traps against the basement, this basement, and this the comparison of these stratigraphic traps with the stratigraphic traps associated with the Rubiales field. Okay, this is the second seismic line in this trip. Look at this is showing the Yaraqui 1X well drilled by Pacific Rubiales in 2011. I'm showing the structural model after drilling. Of course, before drilling, the structural model was more much more sampler than this one. In this well, Pacific got some shows in the, especially in the Cretaceous section, in the deeper part. But it's interesting because look at that. There is a really complex model in this part of the basin. We need higher resolution 3D seismic to map the structural model in this part of the basin. This is a map from the Putumayo foothill, and I just want to show you this. Look at I put here the boundary of the foothill in this part of the basin, showing a transfer, a fall in this area. That is interesting because if you consider that the oil migration is from the deeper part to the shallower part in this area, you can have a structural trap in this area against the, of course, the thrust of the Andean Cordillera, and against this transfer fault. You will see later that there are several oil fields associated with this special structural configuration. At this one, look at this. This is the seismic line B 1991-09. Look at the position of this seismic line is immediately shoulder of that structural configuration that I showed in the previous slide. Here you have the Mirador and Palmera wells, both drilled by Argosy during the 90s. Mirador in 1991, look at the total depth, and Palmera in 1986. It's interesting, look at that. Looks like the Mirador, Miraflores trap is younger than the Palmera trap. Why? Because look at that, the most recent strata are folded in the Miraflor structure, and not in the Palmera. It's not as folded as in Miraflores structure. Interesting. And look at that. It's interesting. This area is the truncation by this important fall in the section up deep in and you can probably you will have oil accumulation in this kind of a structure. There are several wells related to prospect this kind of traps in the southern part of the beach. Now here you have the Cafelina sur one well is close to the Costa Yaco field from Gran Tierra. Is one of the most important with Orito. Is one of the most important fields in the Putumayo Basin. And Lucan is a spectacular structural trap. In this west east line you can see the Costa Yaco and of course the Cafelina well, and the production come from the deeper part, I mean from the Cretaceous section in this structure. There are another structure in the eastern part of Costa Yaco. One of them is Juanambu, and the other is Linda. It's interesting. Look at that. The Costa Yaco field is associated with a reverse fall deep to the west, but Juanambu and Linda are associated with river falls as deep to the east part of the basin. It's interesting. We will see that the two most important oil fields in the Putumayo Basin are Costa Yaco, and the is a river falls deep to the west, and Orito is also a river falls. We will see that later. It's also a river fall deep to the west. Okay, let's continue with this is a productive trend correlation. I know that Arles will explain this in more detail, the correlation between Ecuador and Putumayo. But here it's interesting, look at that. The for example, Orito field, that we will see that field later in this presentation, is associated with a trend in Ecuador, in the western trend in Ecuador. And the most recent discovery in the Putumayo Basin is Platanillo from Amerisur. Okay, now is Geopark. Is associated with the San Sahari and Victor Rugeles trend in this area. And then also that opens the mind to probably to have additional discoveries in this part of the basin. Okay, let's continue with the our trip by the Putumayo Basin. Here you can have a west east very regional segment line showing from the west side of the basin to the east side. You can see the especially the Cretaceous section and the lower tertiary section is really huge, really thick in the west part of the basin, and is pinching out against the basement in the east part of the basin. That generates a huge amount of stratigraphic traps during the pinch out of this Cretaceous section, and we will talk from that potential later in this talk. This little recording area is interesting. This well was drilled by Ecopetrol during the 90s. Was the first well that used a slim hole technology in Colombia. Look at it, it's important depth. It's more than 13,000 feet. I was looking for a possible or a trust, a sub-trust anti-client in this section, and they well got some shows in the deeper part, I mean in the Cretaceous section, but no commercial production from this well in the Niger. And then let's move to the central zone from Condor to Alea, passing through to the Orito. Orito field is in the central zone. Then let's start with this composite line, starting from Condor. Look at that. Condor is a 1992 well drilled by Ecopetrol. Was looking for interesting trap against the main thrusting associated with the Andean Cordillera. Condor got also some shows in the deeper part, I mean in the Cretaceous section. And here is Tapir. Tapir was also drilled by Ecopetrol during that 90s drilling campaign. Remember that Unicornio, Condor, Tapir, and okay, more. And other wells were drilled by Ecopetrol during the 90s in this bay. And here is Orito. Look at the section of the seismic images of Orito. It's a anticline associated with the reverse or thrust fall deep into the west. Okay, I will say it's probably a structure. A flower structure configuration that means associated with a strike slip, also with a compressive regime. That means transpression. We call that transpression associated with the region of Orito. The main production from Orito is coming from the Cretaceous section. I mean, from the Caballos and Villeta formations in the deeper part of the basin. I mean, more or less in this part. Yes, I know. Some of them are asking, okay, did you or Ecopetrol drilled the deeper part? Yes, Ecopetrol drilled a well looking for oil in the eastern flank of this deep structure, but that well just drilled does got some shows in the Cretaceous section, but no commercial production from this part of the structure. Let's move to the south. Close to the boundary with Ecuador. This is also a regional section parallel to the previous one that was in the northern in the central part of the basin in Orito, and here you can see that the most complex structural model is associated with the west part of the basin. But I just want to emphasize, look at that, there are several twins structure, like we call that twins, because are similar in the seismic expression. This is Lorito, this is Hormiga, this is Pomaroso. Then probably there is another opportunity here because it's in the middle of these fields, and it's also similar to the configuration of the previous of the Lorito and Hormiga and Pomaroso. Then it's interesting, look at the Rumillaco field. For me, I don't know. For me, Rumillaco is in the wrong size of the fault. For me, probably if Rumillaco were drilled was drilled in this part, probably there is a today we will have we have another field in this area, and also. We will see that there are several fields in the eastern part of the Putumayo Basin associated with this kind of trap. I mean, subtle traps, subtle probably anticline or of faulted anticlines in the east part of the Catatumbo or the Putumayo Basin. Moving to the east, I mean the continuity from the previous seismic line. Here you can see that the structural model is completely different than the west part of the basin. Here the fields are associated with subtle river falls as Platanillo, as Coenbi, as King de Cumplidor fields are small fields, but are associated with these subtle traps. You can see that the age of these traps is pre Eocene. I mean, the timing of these traps is really good for trapping, because remember that the generation and migration is late Oligocene to early Miocene. Then there is a good timing for these traps for oil accumulation. Let's move to the east. One of the most important fields with the Costa Yaco and Orito is Alea. Alea was discovered by Ecopetrol during the 90s in 1988. And look at that, the trap configuration for Alea is also anticline associated with a reverse fall. The age of that fall for me is pre Eocene. I mean, the timing of this trap is really good, because remember that the generation and migration is Oligocene or Miocene or Miocene, and then the timing for all of these traps are subtle traps, but each of these traps has oil field associated with the structure. Okay, let's move to the eastern part of the Putumayo Basin. In the eastern part, as I mentioned before, all the Cretaceous section is pinching out against the basement. In some cases you can see some stratification associated with Paleozoic strata. And here you have the Caiman Mecaya wells. So you have some production from these wells. But I will concentrate the description with the pinch out with the stratigraphic traps associated with the pinch out in this eastern part of this basin. Of course, the Caiman, Amecaya, Amandur oil is heavier than compared with the AP gravity from Orito, from Costa Yaco. Why? Because during the migration from the Cordillera to this part of the basin, the oil is biodegraded, and that's the reason, because we have heavier oil in this part of the basin. And I just want to mention one well that is for me is a very interesting well, is Solita One. Solita One was drilled by Texaco, Texas Oil Company, in 1948. I mean, that was one of the fields wells drilled in this basin. Look at the total depth is less than 4,000 feet. And Solita One got oil shows in the deepest part, in the deepest section. I will show you later in the next slide the configuration or the oil shows. But what is interesting here? Look at that. There is this is the Pepino. I mean, this is the Cretaceous pinch out. It's again, it's in this part, in some place of this part of the basin. And look at the lower tertiary pinch out is in this solita location. That is associated with a stratigraphic trap. Yes, I put several black lines there showing that probably also there is a structural trap. I mean, it's a combined trap, stratigraphic and structural trap, as in Rubiales. In Rubiales, we also have this kind of configuration. And I also want to emphasize, look at the geometry of this top of basement and conformity. You can see here is subtle, but in the east part of the basin, you will see in the next slides, you will see a very abrupt configuration. I mean, probably associated with intrusive in this part of the basin, and probably in this area, probably you have Paleozoic strata, metamorphic or sedimentary strata, and probably here you have Paleozoic intrusive or pre-Paleozoic intrusive in this part of the basin. What is the importance that you have basement or Paleozoic metamorphic in this area and intrusive in this area? Remember that the intrusive increase the thermal gradient in the subsurface. That's one of the successful keys in Rubiales. In Rubiales, there is a high temperature anomaly in the subsurface, and that's why in Rubiales the heat oil flows easily. If you don't have that temperature anomalies, probably the flow of the Rubiales oil probably were not as easy as it is today. Then it's important to have, if you have heavy oil, it's important to have that temperature anomaly to improve the flow of the oil. Here you have a comparison. Look at that, the vertical scale is almost the same between Solita and Rubiales stress. Look at in Solita, this is the top of the Pepino Formation. We can say that it's equivalent to C7 top, that is the top of the reservoir level in Rubiales. And look at that in Solita, we have this is the resistivity lock, the resistivity response in Solita and in Rubiales. Look at that in the upper part, we have a very important response, but in the deeper part of the Solita, look at that the resistivity is out of the scale, and look at the cores that were getting in the Solita with oil shows completely or fully oil shows, heavy oil shows along the all the Pepino sequence. If you compare that with the Rubiales 3, that was one of the discoveries wells in Rubiales we only have the deeper part, the shallower part of the C7 is with oil. We have water in the deeper part. Probably in Solita, I don't know. We don't have yet the oil water contact. Probably the oil water contact is deeper in the basin. And that increase the size of the Solita oil accumulation. And then, in conclusion, there is a important prospectivity in the east part of the Putumayo Basin. Probably there are several stratigraphic traps because I, we don't we know that in Rubiales the stratigraphic driver is one of the most important, but also we have a structural driver and hydrodynamic high driver in Rubiales producing that, that accumulation. Here in Solita, probably we only have the stratigraphic driver as the accumulation for this heavy oil truck. What is the geometry of that trap, of that Solita one trap? Look at that. For example, in this in this in the location, you have the pinch out of the lower tertiary section, and also probably you have a fall, a normal fall, a small fall. Just say that producing a combined trap. And look at the change. The change in the basement behavior. Look at in this area, the basement response is changing. I mean, probably associated with intrusives. I mean, increasing the thermal or the temperature in this part in the deeper part of the section. I mean, improving the viscosity of the oil, and of course getting easier to flow that oil in the surface. This is the comparison between the seismic in Solita and the seismic in Rubiales. As you saw the comparison of the well logs from Solita Rubiales. Now we are comparing the seismic response of Solita and Rubiales. Look at that in Rubiales also we have interesting or a different basement response in the Rubiales field. I mean, probably that intrusive are generating the high temperature anomaly in the Rubiales field, and probably that's why the viscosity, the oil viscosity in Rubiales field is better than the west field as Amaca or Caño Sur in the Llanos Basin. Now let's look for a perpendicular line. I mean, you saw in the previous slide, you saw west east. Now you are seeing. Perpendicular, I mean, northwest, southeast, showing the 3D geometry for this trap. Also, in the strike line, you can see the pinch out of the lower tertiary section. Look at Solita, the position of Solita. Yes, you can say, okay, Ivan. Also, there is a structural component. Yes, probably as in Rubiales, you have a stratigraphic component and a structural component. I don't know if we have here also a hydrodynamic component as in Rubiales. We don't have enough information from this well. Remember that was a well drilled during the 40s last century. And of course. Moving to the east part of the basin, of the Putumayo Basin, you can see look at the change in the basement pattern. It's interesting. I don't know exactly what is generating the change in this point, but it's associated with that gravimetric anomaly that John Cerón and Álvaro Vargas shown in the gravimetry or the top basement from gravimetry in this foundation. It's interesting. There is a change in the basement. I don't know what is the type of the basin in this side. What is the type of the basin in this side? Because we don't have wells in this part of the basin, but probably that's associated with a intrusive or a
bodies in this parodies.
And moving to the boundary with Ecuador, look at that. There is this is the boundary with Ecuador, and this is also a straight line, shorter than Solita. Look at that in this part of the basin, the lower tertiary section is thicker than in Solita. And in this part, the Platanillo, the more recent discovery in the Putumayo, the Platanillo Basin, the Platanillo discovery is more or less in this section, more or less here. Look at that, it's associated with a small trap or faulted trap in this part of the region. Okay, that's all for today. That was like the description for the basin, and Maria Cecilia will talk about the prospectivity, and Alex will talk about the correlation between Ecuador and the Putumayo fields. Okay, thank you very much, Maria Cecilia.
Good morning, thanks, Ivan. So after Ivan's seismic tour presentation, I want to continue with the play analysis in Putumayo Basin. The main objective of this presentation is to review the regional framework and regional interpretation that I made with the public information from EPIS. From this regional interpretation, it was possible to describe some plays in the Putumayo Basin. I've divided my talk in three parts. To begin, I'm going to talk about regional frameworks. Then I will show you seismics and wealth regional interpretation. And finally, I will describe the plays in the basin with emphasis in stratigraphic traps. So, like we know, the figure on the right shows the sedimentary basins of Colombia, and Caguán Putumayo Basin is in the southwest of Colombia. So here we can see the complete stratigraphic sequencing from the basin. Ivan talked about that. So I prefer to continue with the field history. Exploration in Putumayo Basin beginning in the 40s. With by the Texaco company. This company drilled the Jose Maria, Solita, La Rastra, and Corbinata wells in the northeast sector of the basin. The four wells show patches of tar and heavy oil at the level of Pepino formation. In 1963, the same company discovered Orito field with initial production of 1,411 production per day of API 37 from the Caballos Formation. The Orito structure is the largest field in the basin with reserves around 250 million per barrels. From this discovery, the exploration efforts were oriented towards the surrounding structures, and as other small fields were discovered, such as San Miguel, Acai, Loro, and Churuyaco fields with productions from the Caballos formation. In the 70s, Calimán Company drilled 10 exploration wells in area from the fault belt, discovered Burdini, Nancy, and Maxine fields, all producer from the empty and new sandstone of the formations, the Villeta formations. Then in 1982, Occidental tested a different place in Florencia area, the color blue, but if both the four wells was dry, they were pursuing the presence of crude oil around and cropping some with the presence of tar. Then Ecopetrol discovered the Curiquinga, Quillancinga, Manzoya, and Coimbi fields. And in the early 1990s, Ecopetrol discovered Linda, Mari, Miraflorán, Toroyaco fields in the northwestern region of the basin. So in the 2007, Gran Tierra discovered the Costayaco fields, one of the most important in the basin. And in the same year, the Platanillo Alea field begin to produce, operate by Amerisur company. Most of the fields discovered in the Cadawan Putumayo Basin are associated with the structural traps, such as Orit, Hormiga, Cae, Linda fields, and Toroyaco. But there are other plays that constitute an important exploratory potential in the basin and on which this presentation is focused. So about the AP gravity in the production fields, crude oil trap in the fields on the basin varied from heavy to light, with a range of gravity from 8 to 3.8 API. And biodegradation is a predominant factor in the viscosities and API gravities of crude oils, especially in the eastern portion of the basin. So in a regional transect of well from Esnanga well from Upper Magdalena Valley to the well BHR1 in Orientan Basin, we can see the equivalence of the Cretaceous formations and chain of the thickens in the units. Additionally, the correlation shows the SurfRocks formation La Luna in Upper Magdalena Valley and Villeta formation in Putumayo and Ecuador basins. Also, we can recognize the stratigraphic equivalence in the tertiary sequence from Putumayo to Oriente Basin, where it is important Napo antenna formation in Oriente Basin in Ecuador. So we use around 21 seismic tracks transit along to the basin that were interpreted with 12 horizons were picked and more than 100 wells were studied. Here we can see an example of the transect and the wells interpreted. This transect shows the distribution of the units along the basin where the formation pinch out to the west. And this is another transect from the west to east, where the formation again are pinch out toward the foreland basins. And this is the location of the transect for seismic interpretation and the walls. This is a stratigraphization from walls. We can define the flood levels in the units and the lateral changes in the facies, mainly in Caballos and Villeta formation. So if we continued, this is another stratigraphic section from west to east, when we can see the increment of sandstones to shell ratio to the east of the units and how some units of Villeta pinch out to the east. So we can use a lot of seismic and wells sections around the all basins. And so as we remember, most of the discovered fields in Putumayo are associated with the structural traps. However, they are another important place toward the foreland with an interesting potential in the basin where all information reach out. This is the basement top map, the gravimetric inversion map, where we can see Florencia Palihuay, and there are other positive and negative anomalies. So if we use the gravimetric map with the stratigraphic pinchouts of the formation, we have a good definition of the thorough thickness of the units for Caballos, Villeta, Rumillaco, and Pepino in the east of the basin. So we use the regional interpretation, and then we cross out the parts when the units pinch out, and then we use the basement top map to continue and define the several thickness cross of this unit. So with this exercise, we can a good idea about the continuity of the units and the areas when the unit has pinch out. So here we can see the formation pinch outs again that we can draw in the gravimetric inversion map. So here we have Villeta formation, then Rumillaco, and then Pepino. And we continue with this analysis in another section. So that example of the pinchouts and the relation with the gravimetric inversion map from the Putumayo Basin. Again, we have a pinchout for Villeta, Rumillaco, and Pepino. So after this regional analysis, so we see that interpretation and stratigraphic traps, and we can show some incised violets, probably incised violets in Pepino formations. In the Cretaceous sedimentations, begins an erosional surface on which a fluvial system must have developed that gave rise to incised violet fields. Many of the prospective areas in the basin may be given by the filling of this incised violet or by sands bodies in which the Caballos formation and the Villeta sands show on lap type relations. It should be considered that in the eastern portion of the basin, the Caballos and Villeta units are wedged, so that the infill play of incised violets in this area of the basin will be associated with the Rumillaco and Pepino formations. So here we can see again the Pepino pinch out along the South Big Line and other possible incised violet valley in the area. So in the same area, to the east of the basin, we can see channel systems too in Pepino formation again. That can be an excellent stratigraphic trap in the area. So here we can see other possible incised valley in another line in the area in other block. And other possible stratigraphic traps can be related or can be defined in the Oligocene clastic units. In some areas, we can see these kind of fillers in Orteguasia formations, probably. So after regional interpretation and review of all play styles that we can find in the basin, we describe structural and stratigraphic plays in the area. So here we can have a good regional section. So in the folded truss belt, we can find a structural a place that in the number one are related with thin skin truss with north sorts dipping towards, and the other place are anticlines related to the thick skin systems, like Kongan Churi-Jaco fields. And if we continue to the east, we can describe things skin stress systems, directions north-south, dipping towards northwest. And like Ivan talk, number four are traps formed by inversion of normal faults in related with Puerto Asís fault. And if we can describe the stratigraphic traps in the east of the basin, so we can define in the number A and C, channel fields deposits in this area are related with Caballos and Villeta formation, and in this part is related with Pepin formation. And other good examples are stratigraphic pinchouts in number B. So Caballos, Villeta, Rumillaco, and Pepino formations. And in the number D, we can find incised valley in Pepino formation. And the last one can be clastic oligocene sediments or Teguasa formation equivalent. So in these slides, we can describe both kind of place, structural and the stratigraphic place. And remember that the stratigraphic place are in the east of the basin. So about conclusions in Putumayo basins, we know that the AMP companies have been focused on structural traps, mainly and Cretaceous and Cenozoic formations as source and reservoirs. New place as stratigraphic traps like pinch outs, inside valleys, clastic fields should be studied and explored in greater details because they offer interesting opportunities to find more oil. These opportunities must require new geophysical information and seismic imaging improvement because we need to preserve amplitude and a wide bandwidth that improve seismic resolution in order to identify stratigraphic features. The main risks associated with this type of traps is the seal, the migrations of hydrocarbon, and the integrity of the traps. And additionally, it is possible within the basin the station of the oil and heavy oil belt of Llanos and Paleozoic and petroleum system must be studied. So, thank you so much. I finished my presentation and we continue with Arles' presentation and they're related with the Oriente Basin in Ecuador.
Thank you, Maria Cecilia. This is the agenda of this presentation, beginning with the binational project with the following topics: infrastructure, land, production, and reservoir. After that, with our remaining prospectivity in the basin. In 2018, the presidents of the two nations met in the four binational cabinet as part of the bilateral integration of projects that would be benefit with countries. The INH participate in the second axis on infrastructure and connectivity with the objective of promoting technical exchange between the government entities that administer hydrocarbon resources in Colombia and Ecuador.
Sorry, Alex, can you share the screen, please?
Yes.
We didn't see.
Yes. Yes. Thank you.
Okay, perfect. Thanks, Alors.
Thank you. There are four many activities development in this objective. The first was an exchange of geospatial information. The second, an exchange on seismic card seismic profiles. And the third, that corresponded to the interpretative phase. And the fourth, there is a construction and compilation report. For this first activity was developing first and compilation of the information. In the GIS program, following in this an edition and finally the generation of thematic map, which will show late. For the third activity, the interview, the review, and the loading of the well information for both countries, following by the interpretation of geological tops about the 300 wells in the zone and creation and zone for this calculation of properties such as gross thickness and net to gross ratio. The next was the generation interpolation on information such as production, APA quality of hydrocarbon for each of the reservoir gross thickness maps and net to gross ratio maps. On the left, we have the location of the oil wells in the northern part of the Oriente Basin and the Putumayo Basin. On the right, there is the location of the oil infrastructure corresponding to pipeline facilities and land routes. The infrastructure is connected by the San Miguel Lago Agrio pipeline, which was vital in the 80s when in a natural disaster, the Sote pipeline stopped working and the hydrocarbon was transported by the OTA pipeline. On the board online, there are 18 areas contracted for oil exploration and production, 11 in Colombia and 7 in Ecuador. Only one area is available. In the list of operators, Geopark dominate the area with the green color, following by Gran Tierra with a skin color and in small quality quantity, Ecopetrol with a brown color. In Ecuador, Petro Amazonas with pink color. With regard to production, the three largest fields are in Ecuador, which are Chuchufindi, Libertad, and Fani. And in Colombia, there is the Orito field in complete the group of the fields with more than 300 million barrels produced. In total, the Oriente Putumayo Basin has produced more than 3.6 billion barrels for oil with a ratio of 18.6% for Ecuador and 14% for Colombia. In the production per unit, there is a predominance for producing fields in the Napo Villeta unit, and the west for the basin is dominant is in the Olini Caballos unit. Specifically in the Napo Villeta unit, the main producing level is the U sandstone with about 1.3 billion barrels, following by the T with 1.2 billion barrels and the grouping of Basaltena and Napo Villeta top with 500 million barrels. This is the database that had available for this development in this project. In total, 19 3D programs, more than 800 2D seismic profiles and 302 wells. For this work in interpretation of well, it was decided to make some equivalences for terms on tops. The Caballos formation is correspond to the Upper Olin Sandstone and My Olin Sandstone. At Villeta Napo levels, Limestone C corresponds to the lower chain Napo, sandstone T to the main Napo T, limestone B to upper sandstone T, chain one is a middle chain Napo, U, A, and M2 remain the same in both basins, and the top sandstone N corresponds to sandstone M1 and the Navasal sandstone. The first reservoir project would be presented the Pepino Formation, which has only produced in Colombia and mainly in the Orito fields. It is composed for three levels, a conglomerate basal level. This is the conglomerate basal level. And the intermediate for clay predominance. And this is the clay predominance. And in the top, the upper unit with a more, greater amount of sandstones. The main level is the top member. In the Orito field, is unit has produced about 33 million barrels with an average quality of 26 degrees API. The accumulation map show the source art in production more than 2 million per well. In the northern part, are in production per well almost 2 million barrels, and the smell group is a producing 1.5 million barrels per well. The rest of the field than in sea in green have no production. In the reservoir in the reservoir Villeta Top, Villeta N, and Basaltena Napo M1. Already entering the Napo Villeta unit, we started with the Villeta N, Basaltena, and Napo 1. Is the distribution map most of the fields has produced in this level. Towards the northern part of Putumayo, the accumulation production are around 1 million barrels. Orito, Nancy, and Masoya accumulated between 2 and 4 million per fields. The best producer with Putumayo is Coenbi with more than 20 million. In Ecuador, Fanny and Andorin have production of 115 million barrels each. The major fields such as Chuchufindi, Libertad and Bermejo, Lago Agrio, and VHR between 4 and 10 million of barrels. In the API quality, there is a trend on decrease from the west to the east, to the west or the east, going to 34 in Bermejo to 13 in Vinita, with some anomalous points in low quality such as Mirto and Coenbi, with an average for 14 degrees. For property bass, the eastern zone of Ecuador show the greatest thickness for the level with some anomalies in the north of Putumayo. On average, this unit is between 5 and 18 feet. In the net to gross map, present a non-uniform behavior, which can be interpreted as lack of presence of sandy levels, perhaps due to erosional for this unit. In general, the quality of the unit is between 40% and 60%. For the M2 unit, production is concentrated in Ecuador, in Fanny, Alice, and Dorian fields. In this area, with an average 115 million barrels, and with production between 4 and 10 million in the Vinita and VHR fields. The API quality range from the 29 in VHR to 14 in Vinita. in the thickness distribution, the southeastern arm of Putumayo and eastern Ecuador show the greatest thickness. The quality distribution of the reservoir show the strip that goes to the area to the Mecaya well, which had an hydrocarbon manifestation in the 60s. To the Fanny area, to the anomalous area near to Nancy Bourdin fields. For limestone A, the Costayaco, Orito, and Bermejo fields has been only ones that have important production for this unit. For the Texas map, where is the tendency of decrease from the west to the east, going to the thickness of more than 100 feet on the foothills to 40 in Platanillo and disappear completely in Pinchot in the Airu well on the east. For the level unit, the distribution is toward and the center of the basin, being in the largest production of this level behind the Suchifindi field with the 560 million barrels, the most Berberos. The quality of the hydrocarbon is homogeneous with the average to 25 degrees and the low grade zone in the Coembi field. The thickness of the upper and lower U levels would be greater than in the central part of Ecuador, and the good development in the lower U level in the Suroriente and Platanillo block. And in the net to growth relationship you can make to the paleoenvironmental interpretation of surface in the yellow zone. And towards the green zone, deeper deposit with a low sandstone developed in the west. For the level U, the distribution is toward, for the T sandstone level, the distribution for production is located in the central part of Ecuador and north of Putumayo Basin in the Chaza, Guayullaco, and Santa Ana blocks, with low production in the west in the Orito and Loro Acae fields. In the IPA degree distribution, in general terms, the variations is between 27 degrees and 24 degrees with a central area, there is the value drop cycle to 24. The thickness of the unit present in the an increase in the sort with the Oriente Basin. In the Putumayo Basin remain constant with the north and center of the basin in approximately 50 feet. In the west would be little up of 70 feet and to the east is a decrease in approximately to the border. On the cross map, it showed the 10 of better reservoir in the central part in the west of characteristics decrease amount of sands and chase and limestone when this unit. This distribution could be interpreted as shallow marine facies and the areas when were colors, the facies on coastline and beaches. For the Caballos formation, the distribution of production is focused in the western part of the basin. On the north, in the fields Costayaco Moqueta, on the west, in the fields Orito, Loro Acae, and the fields on suroccidente blocks. In Ecuador, the most representative fields are Bermejo and Lago Agrio. In the area where the production fields are located, the APA values ranging for the 25 and 32 with a some point data above 34 located in Orito field and in Bermejo. The thickness showed the decreasing 10 for the west to the east with a maximum near to the Sucumbios field in the center of the basin. It decreased in a half in the area of Nancy Bourdin and the deposit limit in located is in the Platanillo field, where it is pinched out against the economical basement. The net to gross ratio map show the change of the unit, where to the east, the value is 50% is because the unit is composed for a intermediate section with a fewer sands. Different to the top, the top and the bottom contain higher net to gross value. Toward the middle part of the basin with the decrease in thickness, the lower and middle sublevels has disappeared. In conclusion, the United Charter infrastructure geospatial information between the two nations will be help in the planning of hydrocarbon transportation strategies or the cost reduction in the midstream phase. The knowledge of the actors involved in border blocks will help a better collaboration between the operators of both countries for the development of the new infrastructure. The Oriente Putumayo Basin is in the study as has had an accumulative production of 3.6 billion of barrels, where Suchufindi in Ecuador and Orito in Colombia has been the most prolific. With acknowledge of the accumulation production, all the fields by reservoir allow to know that the most important unit is Villeta Formation and the sublevel U also the best reservoir. In Orito field, it is presented as the only one in the basin that has produced with a Pepino formation. Behind the upper member has managed the production 33 million barrels with 60 wells. In the Villeta formation, the three main reservoirs N, U, T, present a homogeneous distribution for the entire basin with some areas to add more prospectivity for expansion. The M2 and A reservoir would have enough potential for future exploration campaigns. Caballos Formation is the most productive unit in Orito fields and is the fundamental unit in production in the western of the basin. Now, the prospectivity of or remaining in the basin. The largest available areas are located at south of Campo Orito. This is the area one. And areas 2, 3, and 4 located to the east of the fields of Chaza, Guayuyaco, y Santana blocks. Those that were numbered for the 1 to 4. The areas 2 and 3 were evaluated in the cycle 2 in 2018. Areas 1 and 4 have not yet been formally evaluated by the ANH. For this area, the 2D seismic coverage is 1,834 lineal kilometers distributed in 96 profiles in 10 seismic programs. There are a coverage with an approximately area of 167 square kilometers of 3D seismic, and 7 wells have been drilled between 1968 and 2012. In these slides, I can see 2 seismic profiles crossing the list previous proposed by the operator in this block, where you can see in the left and in the left, I can show a horse between falls, between falls. To the north of Guamues well. In the image of the right, some antiforms from the right to the left in continuation to the southwest part of Orito field, and to the left the Churuyaco field. for the area 2, the 2D seismic coverage is the 1,369 linear kilometers distributed in 60 profiles in 10 seismic programs. The area was uncovered with an approximately area of 174 square kilometers of 3D seismic, and three wells have been drilled between 1965 and 2012. In this slide, three structures are shown on the southeast part of the area, characterized by the vein anticline against reverse fault. Main reservoirs are the sandstone N and U in the Villeta Formation. The main risk for this structure is the lateral seal. For this slide, two structures are shown in the northern part of the area, characterized by the anticline against the reverse fault. For a main reservoir are the sandstone N and U in the Villeta Formation. The main risk is the lateral seal. In this slide, three structures are shown in the central part of the area, characterized by the monocline against the reverse fault. Minor reservoirs are sandstone N and U in the Villeta Formation. The main risk of this structure is the lateral seal. In total, for the eight opportunities, there are an accumulated resources for 37 million barrels, the original oil in place. In the area three, the 2D seismic coverage is 1,357 linear kilometers distributed in 78 profiles in seven seismic programs. The area has an coverage with an approximate area of 52 square kilometers for 3D seismic, and five wells have been drilled between 1993 and 2011. In this slide, I show two structures in the southeastern of the area, characterized by vein horse between faults. The main reservoirs are the sandstone N and U in the Villeta Formation and probably Caballos Formation. The main risk of this structure is albedo degradation. In this slide, the structure is in the left are shown in the center of the area, characterized by for the horse between faults. The main reservoir are the sandstone N and U in the Villeta Formation and probably Caballos Formation. The main risk of this structure are biodegradation. The structure of the right are shown in the northeast part of the area, characterized by monocline against the reverse fault. The main reservoirs are sandstone N and U of the Villeta Formation and probably Caballos Formation. The main risk of this structure is a trap presence. In total, for the four opportunities have an accumulative resources for 82 million barrels original oil in place. For the four area, the 2D seismic coverage is 1,464 linear kilometers distributed in 48 profiles in four seismic programs. The area has an coverage with an approximately area of 65 square kilometers of 3D seismic, and six wells have been drilled between 1967 and 2011. For this slide, you can see three types of structures that were defined by the previous operator. The first on the top left and monocline against reverse fault In the profile on the bottom left is possible anticline against reverse synthetic fall, and the right an anticline against the inverse fault. In conclusion, four blocks remain within the Putumayo Basin to be taken in this competitive process. In the areas 2 and 3 that have already been analyzed, there are a total of 110.9 million barrels originally in place. The area 1 can be evaluated taking analogous of discovery of Lombaki block in Ecuador. The area 4 has possibilities of traps on the foothill section with Villeta and Caballos as possible reservoir, and an anticline within a foreland section with Rumillaco, Neme, Sanson as main reservoir. Thank you so much for your attention.
Okay, Alex, María Cecilia, thank you so much for presentation that we have had today. We got just a couple of questions, mainly related to if we could share the presentation about Putumayo and the recording of today. Just to remind all of you that in the chat is already the links that you can find all the presentation that we have had during this whole year. And as well in the YouTube channel of ANH, you can find each of the presentation that we have made before. Related to technical questions, it's about, we got a couple of questions. All the questions that have been addressed to Ivan Olaya have to leave the presentation early. However, he has already answered all of the questions via a chat. So there is a question by, for Alex or for María Cecilia. It's in Spanish. Entonces, Caguán está más relacionado con Llanos que con Putumayo. ¿Sería ¿Y a Caguán, el sur de los Llanos? No sé si Alex o María Cecilia quisieran responder esta pregunta de Nancy Tamayo.
Pues es posible definir que Caguán sea una cuenca similar a Llanos, porque, o sea, parte de Cretácico no es muy visible en esta cuenca, pero es muy similar a lo que se viene siguiendo desde la parte sur del Meta. Pero también habría alguna relación con la parte norte de la cuenca oriente, que tiene las unidades, pues lo que se llama Pepinos, Tuyuyacu, que también tienen esa misma tendencia. Y también habría también la posibilidad de que la parte superior de la unidad Rumillaco, que sería lo que se conoce en la parte norte del Putumayo como la N Formation, sea una correlativa con lo que se viene de Llanos de la parte del Eoceno, que sería pues el Mirador y la unidad que llaman Arrayanes en la parte de Caguán. No sé si María Cecilia quiere decir alguna.
Estoy de acuerdo contigo, Arlux. Así es.
Okay. If any of the attendees have any other question, because there is a question about directly to the round and companies involved into the round, so that will be answered via email for terms of confidentiality, and to maybe be aware of which information we could share and which one we cannot. So if you got any other question that may be answered, that question after any of the presentations, do not hesitate in contacts. There is a question about Germán Patarroyo en la sísmica, ¿hay un buen control de los episodios marinos del Eoceno y Mioceno en la cuenca? No sé si alguno de ustedes dos, María Cecilia o Arlex, pudiesen dar respuesta a esto.
Sí, Daniel y Germán. Parte de lo que de pronto es que les escribí Iván por interno es, y bueno, y para complementar, la calidad de la información sísmica en la cuenca es regular, sobre todo en zonas ya hacia el este o muy alejadas de la cuenca, donde no se han hecho esfuerzos adicionales precisamente por el interés en particular. Sin embargo, se puede hacer, digamos, un control de esos episodios de el Eoceno y el Mioceno.
Y María Cecilia, muchas gracias. Dice Jairo Martín Solano que el link no funciona. Permítanme, lo vuelvo a compartir para que no queden de pronto ninguna... Ahí está nuevamente el link de cada una de las charlas. Como les comentaba, las preguntas las pueden hacer perfectamente a cualquier correo de la NH. Y pregunta Nancy Tamayo, ¿cómo se relaciona Caguán, la cuenca Caguán, con el Valle Superior del Magdalena? No sé si Arlex o María Cecilia quisieran responder esta pregunta.
Sí, puedo compartir una slide que presenté precisamente de una correlación que se hizo con, no sé, ¿la están viendo? Bueno, Daniel, ¿me confirma si se ve?
Sí, se está viendo.
Sí, sí,
gracias. Ah, gracias. Entonces, aquí tenemos una correlación de pozos. El pozo Esnaga, uno de la cuenca del Valle Superior del Magdalena, y aquí tenemos la cuenca Putumayo y la cuenca oriental. Si se dan cuenta, estamos comparando con Quililí, que digamos está más o menos en la parte central de la cuenca, no está tan relacionada hacia la parte norte. Sin embargo, aquí podemos ver una pequeña correlación de la continuidad de las unidades, incluso de las equivalencias, y tener una primera aproximación. Se han hecho esfuerzos y se han hecho algunos estudios, incluso de conectar el Valle Superior con todo el foothills de la cuenca Putumayo, y claro que sí, tienen relación.
Ok, las preguntas no eran de Nancy Tamayo, eran de Juan Pablo Reyes. Estaba el link de Nancy Tamayo. Bueno, Juan Pablo, esperamos se le haya dado respuesta a las dos preguntas, la relacionada con respecto a Llanos y la relacionada con respecto al Valle Superior de Magdalena, la que tiene... no sé si de pronto hay alguna otra pregunta para nuestros dos panelistas. Como les comentaba, desafortunadamente Iván Olaya tuvo que dejar la presentación, y pues igual cualquier pregunta que ustedes tengan a Iván, le estaría encantado responderlas vía email, o si quieren dejo mi email acá en el chat para que ustedes puedan, pues, cualquier pregunta que tengan, hacerla, y yo la redirigiré a cada uno de los presentadores. Creo que a Jorge, Iván ya le había dado respuesta y le había dicho que de pronto la información que tenían de pozos no era suficiente para dar como un modelo geotermal del Putumayo. Sin embargo, esta pregunta la vamos a redirigir hacia Iván. No, Fechi, los links del día de hoy, obviamente, naturalmente la presentación de hoy aún no ha subido porque no ha sido pues terminada la presentación, pero apenas se termine y la gente de comunicaciones tenga ya la grabación completa, pues será subida tanto al canal de YouTube como a la presentación de la NH. Pregunta Carlos Romero. It is possible to correlate the North Sand of Putumayo Basin with the Neme formation of the Caguán Basin?
La responde en español.
Sí, claro, no hay problema.
No, la verdad es que la parte superior de Villeta presenta una parte pues como de calizas y termina en arena, y lo que uno empieza a ver desde Ecuador hasta Colombia es que hay dos unidades. Hay una que sería una unidad que sería una basal de Rumillaco, que lo llaman en Ecuador Tena Basal. Entonces tendríamos un par de arenas, que sería la una que está al tope del Villeta, una que está a la base del Rumillaco, pero la parte del tope del Rumillaco presenta una cuestión bien particular hacia la parte media superior. Las fascias empiezan a cambiar y hay un desarrollo de arenas en esa parte superior del Rumillaco, que empieza a perderse. La parte inferior del Rumillaco empieza a perderse hacia de oeste a este, más o menos hacia la parte donde estaba el pozo Mecalla, por decirlo así, o hacia Manzoya. Se empieza a perder esa parte basal de Rumillaco, y empieza a aparecer más formada la parte superior del Rumillaco, donde empieza a desarrollar la parte de la arena N ya más hacia el noreste.
Listo, Alex, muchas gracias. ¿Otra pregunta? Or do you have any other questions? Bueno, parece que no hay más preguntas por hoy. Nuevamente agradecer a nuestros panelistas, a María Cecilia, a Arlex, por todas las preguntas. Quedo pendiente de responder una pregunta de una de Gigi Chu acerca de la ronda. Y esta pregunta pues se le responderá vía email. The answer of Gigi Chu will be answered directly via email. So thank you so much for everyone that's been here today. And if you got any other further questions, do not hesitate in contacting us via email. And we'll see you next Friday in the usual presentations. Thank you so much for everyone.